This is a good recording, man.
Yeah, brother, dig it. Stop it. Right on.
Brother, 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 there's far too many of you die.
I think anyone who puckers up their lips and presses it against their boss's buttocks and then smooches is an ass kisser.
I seem to be inept at everything except my work. I'm good at my work. So I confine myself to that. All I want out of life is a 30 share and a 20 rating.
The man's enlarged my mind. He's a poet, warrior in the classic sense. I'm a little man. I'm a little man. He's a great man.
Think of it as colors. There's black and there's white. And in between is mostly gray. That's us. Now, gray is a tough color because it's not as simple as black and white. And for the media, certainly not as interesting. But it's who we are.
Fan Radio Network.
That's all, I'm done.
And KFAN.com. 2 minutes, 10 seconds past 3 o'clock Central Daylight Saving Time. Bumper to Bumper Show back. It is a midweek edition of the program. Full 3.5 hours tonight, going to 6:30. Double looks check. Like, sometimes like something comes up that we forget about.
6:30 tonight.
3.5 hour tour on what I like to call a hardball edition of the show. Can we steal that name? Once upon a time, there was a show, I think it was on CNBC and then MSNBC, called Hardball.
I think enough time's passed.
Chris Matthews was the, I think, the ringleader. He was like the anchor. Longtime inkstained wretch, political writer, turned to the dark side of broadcasting. He's still alive, is he not? I don't think he's on much. I think he got canceled for something. Or semi-canceled, if I'm not mistaken. Chris Matthews. The show is called Hardball. I want occasionally for us to, we come up with alternative names for this show. The afternoon aardvark, the beast, the a-hole in the afternoon. I want Hardball to be another one we can occasionally go to.
I think we can use it. Yeah, the show has not run since 2020.
So not that far off, really. Only 4 years, you're saying. That's not completely in the rearview mirror.
He announced on his final episode he was retiring following an accusation that he had made inappropriate comments to a Hardball guest 4 years earlier. Ooh. On that occasion, well, I don't even know if I want to read. I don't
is
know
it,
if I,
is it pretty.
I want to make sure I want to make sure
be careful.
I can.
Yeah. Just untoward comments, one could say.
Okay, I don't even have that comment yet.
All right.
But anyway, so he did get canceled in a way.
Yeah, I remember there was something about that. We're going with Hardball today.
Okay.
For better or for worse. Bort and Volvo guest lineup for today's edition of Hardball. We'll give you details on that in just a minute. We'll also reboot the Bradshaw and Bryant KFAN text line 64686. Texter 725 asks, am I blocked again? The answer is clearly no, because I can read your message. So you are...
Congratulations. Don't test it.
Don't tempt me. And don't tempt the Bradshaw and Bryant Cafe and text line gods, is what I would indeed say. Barking with Barrero. That's another alliterative one, I guess, that we could go with from time to time. Lots to get to on the show today. We've got some very intriguing Minnesota Timberwolves cloak and dagger news to discuss. I don't know how much it's been discussed on the fan earlier today, but it definitely caught my attention. But I want to start with the Lindbergh baby. Now, Lindbergh Baby was an old reference here. In bumper-to-bumper vernacular, alert the media, have you heard about the Lindbergh Baby, is to say you've just spoken the very obvious. The kids probably don't know who the Lindbergh Baby was. Kidnapped child of Charles Lindbergh, who I think our terminal, is it still named after him? Because he got semi-canceled.
That's why it's just Terminal 1.
Oh, they did change
it.
Okay, Terminal 1.
I think
one.
So, yeah.
Okay.
Terminal 1 and Terminal 2, because it used to be the Humphrey Terminal as well.
That's
right?
That's true.
That was Terminal 2.
Did HHH get canceled as well?
I don't think so. I just think we're covering all our bases.
We probably are.
We've had to rename a lot of stuff.
We have, yeah. No question.
So, I think it's just better to call things by numbers.
But, ironically enough, it was a horrible story at the time because the baby was not found alive. Remains were found, and there's an ongoing belief that the wrong people got convicted and I think death penaltied back in the day. And just like within the last, I'm talking about the last week or two, I think the New York Times just had another big story about a new investigation that has a theory that Charles Lindbergh himself is implicated in the kidnapping and death of his own child. Now, other people historians who follow this story closely, they ain't buying it, but it shows you how, even though it's ancient, it's still fresh. It's constantly coming back to us. And so today we're using it in the bumper-to-bumper vernacular of, I'm looking at a headline and I'm saying, alert the media, have you heard about the Lindbergh baby? And what's the headline? 2000, this is out of USA Today, 2024 World Happiness Report has been released. Did you see it? Happiest countries revealed.
Oh, boy.
And we apparently have made history. Now, I don't know how many years the happiness report, the World Happiness Report goes back. I believe this is through the auspices of the United Nations. Did you also know that today, interestingly enough, and perhaps this is why the United Nations chose to release the report today. Did you know that today, is today the 20th?
Yes, March 20th.
Today is International Day of Happiness. Are you familiar with that?
I've never heard of it.
I hadn't either. International Day of Happiness. Now, I'm reading a little further. It was first released 12 years ago. So it doesn't have, you know, a long history, but over a decade. And according to the story put together by Julia Gomez in USA Today. There are other versions of this story, I believe, elsewhere. For the first time, well, first of all, do you want to hazard a guess on the three happiest countries in the world? And when we say a country can't be happy, they mean obviously the people within a country. You want to take just a gander, a flying, you know.
I'm going to go like Denmark, Norway, Sweden. I'm going that direction.
Well, a good start. Denmark ranks second.
Okay. Good
Finland
cycling.
Ranks first.
I figured we'd be in that area.
Scandinavian.
Yep.
And Iceland, interestingly enough, is number three. Iceland is three. You mentioned Sweden. They're four.
I never get this close on guesses.
This surprises me a little. Israel is fifth.
That's interesting.
Man, I didn't see that coming. Given what, you know, ongoing Middle East battles. Netherlands, six. Norway, seven. Luxembourg, eight. Switzerland, nine. And Australia, 10. Second, 10. New Zealand, 11. Costa Rica, 12. Kuwait, 13, Austria 14, Canada 15, Belgium 16, Ireland 17, Czechia 18, did I say Ireland? Yeah, 17, Czechia 18, Lithuania 19, and the United Kingdom 20. What's missing? Well, for the first time since the World Happiness Report has been released, the United States has not cracked the top 20.
It's frustrating.
For the record, we are at number 23, also trailing the United Arab Emirates at 22 and Slovenia at 21. And of course,
where are we, America?
The teeth gnashing has started. My God, how's that possible? Why are we so unhappy? What happened to us? Is it political polarization? Is it sharks and jets? That we revile each other on each side of the political aisle more than we ever have before? Is it crime? Is it inflation? Is it the fact that we can't seem to find some up-and-coming, emerging presidential candidates who are under the age of 90? All those things I'm not denying might have something to do with it, but they're not the number one reason. I have the number one reason, and it's not even close. It's not even close. The number one reason we're no longer in the top 20 and we're headed the wrong direction. And next year we might even, I don't know, maybe we won't even crack the top 30. I'm not sure. Is that we can't stop asking each other, are you okay? You sure you're all right? Especially of kids. Are you traumatized? Was that a traumatic experience for you? Well, it sure looked like a traumatic experience for you. You seem okay, but are you hiding something? We've talked about this before. Even the psychologists who believe, obviously, in the importance of nourishing the mind are saying, we've jumped the shark. There is a middle ground here where, especially because I think a lot of these numbers indicate the worst numbers are the kids.
Yeah.
As in children and young adults as well. What's the, if you're between 20 and 30, what generation are you? Do we even know?
Question. Yeah, we know.
Is that Gen Z?
It might be.
Okay, whatever it is, that's it. We can't stop asking each other how we're doing. And believe me, if you keep asking people, especially impressionable people, as often as we do, they start going, well, you know, I thought I was okay. That wasn't fun. But it's part of life growing up. I'm going to try to deal with it. But you're telling me that maybe it is affecting me more than I thought. How can we have anybody happy who's left? So we've gone in this country, I would argue, from one extreme, which was dismissing any concern about mental health and about emotional issues and challenges, to the other end of the deal, where we're doing it every 13 seconds. We talked about how that affects things in schools, how even as, again, the trained psychologists have said, look, not everybody is clinical. Part of building a life, surviving, growing, is to understand there are going to be pratfalls, there are going to be frustrations, but not every frustration means you have a psychosis. But if you tell people over and over again, that's got to be something, there's got to be some pill we can give you for that, then I think it's more likely psychologically, is it not, to say, you're telling me I shouldn't feel very good. You know, I think you're right. I don't. I've come to think of it. I thought I was okay, but you've asked me 10 times today. Now I'm beginning to think there's something wrong. If we want to make a jump next year, and let's remember this date and let's get back to it a year from now. We want to make a jump back into the top 20 next year. That's got to be the goal. Stop every 15 seconds saying, are you okay? I'll give you more details on that about what some of the psychologists say, because it's real and I believe it. Difference between having your antenna up and being sensitive and not being dismissive of all challenges and burdens and difficulties and sending the exact wrong message to your kids and to others that every problem is intractable and every problem gives you the opportunity to curl up in the fetal position. More to come in our first guest at 3:30.
Head over to KFAN.com, keyword contest. Enter for your chance to win a pair of tickets to be there when the Minnesota State High School League Boys Basketball Tournament takes the court. That's today through the 23rd at Target Center and Williams Arena. And don't forget, you can watch all the action on 45 TV. 45 TV, the official home of the MSHSL tournaments.
a psychologist who's done a lot of research in these issues regarding emotions, what's described as self-regulation among young people. And she says one of the mistakes we're making is constantly asking, again, are you okay? In fact, one of them says, we know that chasing positivity for yourself is actually associated with low psychological function, that it's associated with more depressive symptoms. Emotions are highly reactive to our attention to them. Certain kinds of attention to emotions, focus on emotions, can actually increase emotional distress. If we want our kids to be happy, the last thing we should do is communicate that happiness is the goal. The more vigorously we hunt it, the more likely we are to be disappointed, regardless of the conditions of our lives. Research shows how malleable our emotions are, how vulnerable they are to manipulation. This makes our feelings somewhat unreliable when it comes to diagnosing what's going right or wrong in our lives. But we communicate the opposite when we ask kids to constantly examine, how do you feel? We're basically telling them that this deeply imperfect signal is always valid, is always important to track, and then use it to guide your behavior, use it to guide how you act in a situation. Here's another one. Another professor of psychiatry in Berlin, asking somebody how you're feeling is inducing negative feelings. You shouldn't do it. Why? Well, nobody feels great. Never, never, ever. Sit in the bus and look at the people opposite you. They don't look happy. Happiness is not necessarily the emotion of the day. When we've talked about this before, and we have, and quoted other psychologists, they've said that part of their concern is that people start expecting and demanding a label for something that is pathological or something that is psychological. And all that tends to do is diminish the real psychological, you know, like clinical conditions that are out there, which are real, and makes it, I think, too easy to for especially young people to misunderstand that there are going to be some difficulties. And if you're having those difficulties, you don't deny them. You don't mock them, but you try to communicate to them that this is going to be part of the rite of passage. Now, this is not exactly like there's a texter who has said, aren't you the guy who hates the expression man up? And essentially, isn't that what you just told everybody to do? Genuine curiosity, not a criticism. I would say, no, that's not. It's a good question. I would say it's not what we're doing. I'd say we're looking for a balance. But if in attaining a balance, there are times when, whether you use that expression or not, it might be the best message to deliver to people, I don't think that's irrational, and there are many psychologists who agree. Now, they probably wouldn't use it in that, you know, particular term because of all the connotations of it, but that some of the things that need to be conveyed aren't necessarily going to be the easiest maybe answer that people are looking for. How could we possibly in this environment think we're happy? We can't crack the top 20 under these conditions. And so I'm not surprised we're going the wrong direction. We've talked about it in college campuses. It's almost trite at this point to talk about, you know, microaggressions and the degree to which there's even a book, I think, out called The Coddling of the American Mind that I think also contributes to this same issue. If you tell a kid that every time they see this, this, and this, they're likely to be traumatized, what do you think they're going to believe? They're going to be conditioned to believe, yeah, I am. I'm traumatized. I'm triggered. And I think now there's an attempt to start a counter-revolution on college campuses a little bit to say, well, that's not what we're about here. You might hear us see some things that might challenge you. Not talking about, obviously, racist items. We're not talking about things that go well over the line and threaten people's safety. I mean, literally threaten safety, because that's another weapon that's used to shut down different opinions, is I feel like I'm threatened. But it, to me, it all kind of fits together to the same, we end up in the same place. I'm just trying to get us back to the top 20 in a poll that I didn't even know existed.
Yeah, well,
that's
what
all
can
we're
we
trying
do?
To do. Everybody, I think, is trying to contribute.
Can we assume that the Scandinavian countries never ask anybody how they're doing then? Is that the leap we can make? That, well, if you go to Finland, no one says, how you doing? Or they just say, hello. Okay, let's get to work. Let's get on our bike and let's do what we need to do.
My guess is less so, but maybe we have some folks from Scandinavia who can help us with that, who've spent some time there. 612 guy says, you aren't saying man up. What you're saying is emotions in life are normal, right? Bingo. That's it. And that's what the psychologists I respect say. Emotions in life are normal. Going to be some good ones, going to be some bad ones. The challenge is to try to channel through it, figure out the best ways through it, without automatically wanting to have to slap a, well, that's a syndrome. Capital, you know, capital letters, that's a condition. I'm pretty sure you've got it, or you're going to be pretty sure you've got it. If that's the effort to quickly turn it from emotions to, got to be something more serious than that, whether it is or not. That's true. Pay more people. They are happier. That's 701 guy. Are they? I think to a degree, I'm sure there's some truth to that. I mean, we've got...
might buy some happiness.
We've got some significant inflation issues that continue to affect people each and every day. Dan, you cannot be happy or sad in life. Those are emotions that come and go, but never stay permanently. Hold on. Bear with me. Instead, the question really should be whether or not you are content with your life. That is really at the root of what we are all trying to achieve, is contentment. Interesting. And I don't know if the story indicates the exact, you know, wording, because that's a good point. What do they ask people? How do we know? Let's see. In the top 10 countries, only the Netherlands and Australia have populations over 15 million, which in of itself is rather interesting. In the whole of the top 20, only Canada and the United Kingdom. That's what I just read. The World Happiness Report reveals, shocker, youth aren't happy in the United States. They have no chance to be. No chance. Interestingly, what do we make of this? The report did a breakdown, also ranked the happiness of different age groups. The United States ranked in the top 10 when the report analyzed the happiness of, quote, the old.
America.
The old defined as people aged 60 and over. But when it came to the happiness of the young, folks younger than 30, we are ranked 63rd. Well, maybe the old, to a certain degree, they're in a different position, but maybe they also didn't grow up in that environment that said, you okay? You sure everything's okay? Just asking. I'm here to help. I'm here to try to get us to that next place. And I think, like I said, I've read like a million versions of theories of what this might be. And all of them have probably some validity. I think what I'm talking about should be at the very, very top of the list, but I'm not sure people are all that comfortable talking about it. But they have in other contexts. Psychologists, I'm talking about licensed professionals in the field of studying the mind and emotions. This is what you're getting more and more from them, is that we've gone from, the pendulum has swung from one extreme way too far to the other. And what are we left with is a bunch of kids who, shockingly, after being asked if you're okay, if you're sure you're happy, they don't seem all that happy at all. You know who's pretty happy? Our next guest is pretty happy.
We're returning
to the toy department. His basketball team is headed for the Elite Eight. We'll identify him, talk to him, and give you details now.
This is what college basketball is all about. 42-41 Bearcats. 5 seconds to go. First free throw by Dreamer. Is no good. Rebound. They're not going to take a timeout. Malik across the timeline. Malik to Hayescamp for the win. His shot is up. Yes! Eliza Hayescamp hits the jumper at the buzzer. And Minnesota State is going to Elite Eight. Hayescamp in transition knocks it down at Minnesota State.
And they'll take a look at it for sure. But what an ending to that game.
They're going
to
cut down the nets. Evansville, Indiana. Here comes the Mavericks.
This song?
I hope we can. We'll find out.
All is ticked. Still gives you goosebumps, doesn't it?
Every time. How could it not?
Never stops with you.
No.
Ever. You just heard the big finish last night via 1230 The Fan in Mankato, Minnesota. Minnesota State, Mankato. In desperate trouble. Wins at the buzzer, 43-42 over Northwest Missouri State in the championship game of the NCAA Division II Central Region in Mankato. And now, as you heard, advances to the Elite Eight. The head coach, an old friend of this show, going way back, kind enough to join us via the Connecticut Water Systems Hotline, the head coach, Matt Margenthaler. Coach, have you come down yet from the big W?
I have not, Dan, and I'm sure I can ask you how you're doing after that last segment. But I tell you what, man, I have not slept. I mean, we slept maybe a couple hours, my wife and I, but we stayed up all night long. And when you played that segment there from the radio, I got goosebumps too. I mean, it was an amazing night for our program.
It really was, and the highlight was very cool to see as well. I watched it earlier this morning, and then I saw actually the tweet from Guardsy that you were already booked, which we'd all kind of planned. I mean, we were going to hold out. We said, well, make them get to the Elite Eight, and then we'll get back to them. But you did. You got to the Elite Eight. Here's what I want to know. So did you have, like, was it like 18 points at the half? What happened to your vaunted offense here? Is it something they did? Is it a way they play? Or were you guys just off? Tell me about, you know, fighting through that and how concerned you were about them stealing the game.
Well, I would have been happy with 18 points at halftime. We had 17.
Whoa.
And it was bad. I mean, it's just the way they play. They come down the floor. They won a low possession game.
Right.
It's worse than Virginia the way they play. it's really, really a boring style of basketball. One that I would not want to coach at all. I couldn't recruit to that. There's no way. But they did a great job of hurrying us up, you know, a defensive end. And we took some quick shots in the first half, but I thought our guys really settled in late in the first half, going into the second half. And the one thing that kept us in the game ourselves was defensively. We were extremely, extremely solid and very physical, rebounded the heck out of basketball. We held them to 17 points in the second half, and that's what allowed us to have an opportunity to win.
So you are down one. They're at the free throw line with, what was it, like 5 seconds to go.
Five.
And fortunately for you, the Bearcats missed the front end of the 1-1. So was there a timeout right before then? I mean, what are you asking them to do at that point?
There was not. We fouled and in my career, I don't call a timeout. We talk about it all the time, situational stuff in practice. And we knew we were just going to go. The thing I was concerned about, Northwest still had three fouls to give.
Ooh.
And so I was blown away that they didn't foul us.
That's a great
point. We had to go 94 feet, and they didn't even come close to fouling us. And give my point guard, Malik Willingham, who's Waseca, Minnesota native. He's been an All-American for us this year. I would have lost my house because he had his hands on the ball, and I would say he was going to try to take that shot.
Sure.
And he made the exact play, and that was really even bigger than a shot. He made the right move by giving Elijah the shot, and everything worked out for the better.
And how long was that shot by Elijah, would you say?
It was only 12 to 15 feet.
Yeah.
But it was like at the, you know, they had to go to review it, and there was no question it was good in my mind. Obviously, the officials like to go to the monitor so they can be seen a little bit for the game. But it was, they made the right call. Elijah, it was a tough shot. It was a guarded shot. It wasn't like it was wide open. He made a tough shot. And Elijah, for his year, he's been one of our better shooters percentage-wise. And he was like, that was his only field goal for the night, Dan.
Wow.
So that last shot, that was the only one. And He had that and one free throw, and that was it.
So when it happens that way, do you start thinking, yeah, we know we're good because you guys have been good all year. What's the record? 32-2?
32-2.
So, which is a damn good record, and we're going to talk about the fact that they reseed Division II, and you are the number one seed as you prepare for your next game Tuesday night. But you start going, yeah, we're good, but maybe we also got the gods going too, the basketball gods as well. Why not us? Why not now?
You know, I think, you know, along these types of runs, you have to have, you're going to have games like this, and you're going to have to win a game like that to get to where you ultimately want to go, which is Saturday, playing for the championship. And so we've had a couple along the way, not too many, but our guy, we have a veteran group that has played a lot of college basketball, and this is probably not my most talented team I've had in Minnesota State, but it's the most selfless team I've ever had, and that's why we're at 32-2 right now.
13, that was your 13th straight victory. Now, I saw the video, but I don't know if I remember. Was there big-time court storming, and did anybody get hurt? Like, did you get hurt, or any of your players get hurt, or what was the court storming like?
We did have court. I tell you, the Taylor Center last night was
Was it rocking?
Second best crowd we've ever had. Over 4,600 people in the gym. It was they came on the court like their football team was all over the place. It was awesome. And so then we tried to get them off the court for a while, but then we just said, heck with it, let them have fun. And I'm all about court storming right now. Let's do it.
Yeah. What was your I didn't see your reaction immediately. Are you jumping up and down? Are you immediately on the court? Are you just grinning ear to ear? What's your immediate reaction?
What I did first, I went right to the official and started screaming at him, you got to count it, you got to count it, you got to count it. And I think I said that about 15 times, and I was screaming at him. And then they counted it, and I just kind of just looked back. And really, you know, it's interesting because this is our second time now going into the Elite Eight. And I stood back, and I just wanted to take everything in because I didn't do that 10 years ago. Now I'm getting a little bit older, and I just want to enjoy the moment. And that's something I've done. I got my dad here with me.
That's great.
My wife, two boys, and we just kind of sat back and enjoyed the whole thing. And that's really what it's about because these guys, I mean, I'm happy for our players. That's really, really what this is all about.
There's no question about that. So you now, Garzy tells me that they reseed. So you do have the number one seed. You're going to face Ferris State, the 8 seed, Tuesday night in Evansville. So what do you think of the position that you're in here? What are your early thoughts on them? And refresh my memory about what you guys did. I think it was 2011 was the last time you were in the Elite Eight. What happened on that occasion?
It was, Dan. That's when we started this whole thing. We talked on in Springfield, Mass. And we did get to the semifinals.
Okay.
We won the first game. Got beat by Bellarmine, who ended up winning the national championship that year. Being a number one seed is great, but really, seeding really doesn't mean much right now.
Yeah.
We got 8 of the best teams in Division II going against each other, but it is it's nice. I don't know much about Ferris. I've been up at the state tournament today. I'm heading home right now. I'll be working on Ferris State tonight. But one thing I do know is they like to score, like to get up and down the floor, and I like that because that's the way we play. So it won't be, I guarantee it won't be a 42-43 game.
Has that always been the way you like to play?
It is. I've done that from day one, and we get out and run. I let our guys play, and I demand great effort on defensive end. That's my whole thing. And if they do that, then I give them freedom on the offensive end.
And by the way, I mean, I'm sure in Mankato this is well known, maybe not so much here, your women's team. The Minnesota State Mankato women's team is also in the Elite Eight. Has that ever happened in school history?
It has not. This is a very historical year for both men's and women's basketball. And Emily TC, our head coach, has done an unbelievable job with her women. And they just rolled through their Central Region tournament. I mean, it wasn't even close. And they play just a really crazy style defensively and create a bunch of turnovers. And they have a great opportunity to win a national championship themselves.
Tell me about the Willinghams.
Well, I tell you what, they've made my job a lot easier this last year. Both brothers from Waseca, Malik is a senior, Kyrese is a junior. These guys, they do nothing but know how to play basketball. They grew up in the playgrounds and they hoop all the time. They bring just a great vibe every single day. These guys play with a smile, and they play with such passion. And they're just, they're two young men that, that love Minnesota State. They've been very loyal to Minnesota State. And, I sold them this vision, Malik, 5 years ago, and to be able to live it out right now and go through it with him and his brother, there is just, and Dan, through my career, there's just nothing better.
Is there such a thing as the portal in Division II? How does Division II work? We know how Division I works and how much it's bugging all the established coaches. What's Division II like in that regard? Is there a portal?
There is a portal, and we have three on our team right now.
Okay.
And I've been on the phone today already with three or four young men on the portal. And it does. It just all filters down. You know, the biggest difference for us, we don't have the NIL money. We just don't have that at our level.
Sure.
But, you know, the portal is very, very prevalent, and we will use that. And, you know, we've lost some kids in Division I because of the portal, but we've gained some stuff, too. And so you just got to – it is here, and you have to be if you don't use it, then you're just going to get behind.
You're in – this is your 23rd year? Is that right?
It is.
You're 23.
Is. Yep.
You're still a young man, though. How old are you?
I'll be 56.
Oh, yeah, you're a pup. So – are you like, I mean, are you, do you envision yourself as somebody who's like, yeah, I'm going to keep going. I got nothing to do. I'm not burned out. I love this. I'll coach another 20 years. Do you give much thought to that?
I give it thought, but Dan, I'm not going 20 years. I'm just glad I'm coaching there this year. I didn't know after last year what was going to happen, to be quite honest with you, if I was going to be back here at Minnesota State or not. And I'm glad that I'm here. I've signed a 3-year contract, but I'll tell you what, I'm going to be going to my AD's office next week and get an extension.
I would hope. So,
no, I mean, seriously.
So we'll fill in some gaps here. I mean, were you like on the, did you think it was over for you after last season? What are we talking about here?
I did. Honestly, I thought that it might be done. You know, being at one school for so long, yeah. You know, we had COVID years, the 2 years of COVID,
right,
that we struggled with and everyone struggled with. And then had two just average years. You know, I really didn't. We had some long conversations, and I really, honestly, gosh, didn't know if I was going to be back. And I'm glad they wanted me back, and I think they made the right decision.
Yeah, I would say at this point they probably do. Keep us posted on that. Those contract extension conversations.
Yeah, we need to break that.
You know,
we need to break that.
I wouldn't mind. I mean, can you break it now? Is it like anything we can break yet, or is it a little premature?
No, I'm sure my AD will love me talking about this, but that's okay.
No, that's the beauty of it. Yeah, I'm glad you're so honest about it. It's even better. And, you know, it's interesting because over the years, we've talked a lot, as you're a loyal listener of the program, which I really value and much appreciate. Even though we don't always talk, I have some awareness about it, especially through Guardsian, and I really do appreciate it. And so you probably heard us with Glenn Mason from time to time. And Mason, I think, his post-coaching career has come up with an interesting theory where he says, if I were recommending to young coaches who've been at one place 7, 8, 9 years, I'd always say, if you got another opportunity, grab it, get ahead of the posse, because they're going to come for you sooner or later, and then you get to restart the clock at the new place. The new place, you got the built-in honeymoon period, and so, you know, don't wait for them to come and get you, even if you think you're doing a pretty good job, if you have another opportunity. And it's interesting, in your position, I mean, I guess you could say the same thing. I'm sure you've probably had some other opportunities, that that's sometimes the risk is that you hang around too long and people, they get tired of you, even if they shouldn't.
That's exactly right. And that's something that, you know, my dad coached his whole entire career, and his advice to me is never tell him you want to be there. Never tell him you want to stay. And, yep. And because you always want to be on the move. I listen to Glenn all the time, and I think his segment with you is just awesome. The one advice that I took from him years ago, he always said you have to have that file, right? You have to have that file with names on it, and so that's something I got that file, Dan.
That's it.
I will keep it with me, but it's, you know, Minnesota State's a special place. Both my sons graduated from here. My wife graduated from here. It's a special, special place. We love it. And we have some great friends and great support, and that's where I'm going to end my career. I know that, and I think the university knows that too. And we'll see when that is. I'm not sure, but hopefully five to 7 years.
Yeah, that sounds about right. The buzz on campus, is it palpable? Are people getting into this thing?
They are. You know, they find. I think they finally found out we have a basketball program in Mankato, not just hockey. And it was unbelievable last night. I mean, and both, you know, with both our men's and women's teams doing the things they're doing, our university has really supported basketball and the Division II athletics so well. And we have a new president Inch, who's been outstanding. I mean, he last year he went out to California with us. I mean, he's been supporting us like crazy. Our athletic director Kevin Bison's done an unbelievable job. So it's a special place to be, and always will be.
Who won the Division II title last year? Are they among the Elite Eight coming back?
They are. The number 2 seed, Nova Southeast, which is out of Florida.
Okay.
And so they'll be in there, and we'll see them hopefully on Saturday. But, you know, Northwest Missouri's won 4 of the last 5 national championships. So
wow.
To get through that program last night was one heck of a feat for us. And to do it at home, and like I said, in front of the rowdy crowd was just an unbelievable experience.
It is fascinating to hear you remind people that your opponent did have fouls to give. And that is shocking. I mean, did you get any? I mean, it's not your job to ask the other team, obviously, and their coach. But any theories on that? Because as you say, if you play that game right, you could end up leaving you. Maybe you'd be in the front court by then, but you might have almost no time left to get the shot off.
Exactly right. I honestly, I don't like to be friends with coaches that I compete against.
Yeah.
So I really didn't ask him. And and he mentioned something in his press conference about that. I thought that he probably screwed up by not fouling at that time. But it's, you know, I think when the free throw was missed, we did such a good job. Kyrie got the board, threw it to his brother Malik, and we went out so fast.
Yeah.
I think that we were in half court and just in a split second. I think they almost got concerned about fouling, because they thought it may just, you know, obviously if we're going up for a shot, they didn't want to do that. So I thought they just kind of got a little bit scared there at the end.
Matt Margenthaler is our guest. He is the head men's basketball coach at Minnesota State Mankato. They knock off Northwest Missouri State last night at the buzzer in Mankato to advance to the Division II Elite Eight. We'll be taking on Ferris State on Tuesday night. Before we let you go, you know, you're in a position where I think to a certain extent you can maybe speak more freely than even some, you know, Division I coaches can. And I was talking to a couple people today about this who are very tight with college basketball at the Division I level. And they're saying, you know, I get it that there's so much money to be had here. There had to be a way to try to include players somehow. But they're reaching a point. In fact, this one case, I won't name the school, but it was, there's a player who's already taken away, who committed to one school and is now leaving, even though apparently there was like a, I don't know, like a $3 million NIL deal that he's walking from. And that person said, you know, I'll tell you, I'm not even, in 5 years, we're not going to recognize any of this, the craziness of it, where it's headed. How crazy is it from your perspective? And where do you think, are we even going to recognize college, so-called major college basketball in 5 years?
I don't think we are. I don't know if there's going to be an NCAA.
Right.
To be quite honest with you, you know, I'm on the board of directors for the NABC and the Division II rep, and it's amazing to listen to. And I'm like a fly on the wall that these stories that are going on, and I couldn't imagine trying to be a Power Five basketball coach, football coach,
yep,
and having to deal with the money that they're having to deal with and the portal and everything that's going on. That's a hard thing to do. And I agree with you. College sports is going to be different. And it's different now, but I can't imagine what it's going to look like in 5 years.
Yeah, no question. Well, as you said, you know, a lot of coaches talk about, now you don't have to worry about the NIL stuff, which is probably a blessing to an extent, because you don't have to get in the middle of that stuff. But there's the ongoing issue that I've talked about with many coaches about whether the ability to challenge players in the way that the best coaches do without being necessarily abusive is getting trickier all the time, knowing that they can, you know, say, all right, I'm done. I don't need to listen to this. I'm gone. Does that change the way, in any meaningful way, the way you go about your coaching?
Not for me. I think that I can see that at a Division I level or a Power Five level where you're paying these guys. And, you know, there's going to be players. I talked to one of my buddies who's an assistant coach in the Big 12, and he was saying that next year he'll have three players on his team that are making more money than him. I mean, that's unbelievable. That's unbelievable. And so I think those guys do walk on eggshells at times.
Yeah.
You know, I don't have to do that here at this level, which is great. We still have the student athlete here, which I really appreciate that. And, but again, we deal with the portal. I mean, everybody wants to play. That's the thing. And you know, you look at all these guys that are in the portal. I think there was 27% of guys that went in the portal last year, that had a scholarship. They didn't get a scholarship after the portal was done. So they're going from there. We're talking about full ride guys going in the portal and leaving with nothing. Yeah. And that's going to happen to a lot of these young men.
It is remarkable. All right. So Evansville is the venue for the championship round, the Elite Eight. You got to win three to win the whole thing. So does your crowd, are they going to travel? What's the atmosphere like at these events?
You know, it's not going to be like it was last night. Yeah. You know, that last night's crowd will be the best crowd that we'll play in front of the rest of the year. We get to Evansville. It's more of a central region type of, mm-hmm. of area. I think we'll travel well as a Maverick fan, but, you know, there won't be 5,000-6,000 people there. It'll probably be more like 1,500 to 2,000 in a big facility too. So it makes it a little bit different. But Evansville's done a nice job of hosting the Division II national championships the last few years. And, coached a, all-star game down there a couple of years ago. And it's a beautiful facility. And obviously Indiana loves their basketball.
And yeah, there's no question about that. And Guardsy and I agree all big events, college basketball wise should be in the state of Indiana, either Indianapolis or Evansville. That's an inside joke because Guardsy's bitter about one tweet. He's becoming
multiple
more,
tweets.
He's become more like me than ever because he finds one person and then he loses his mind, which I've unfortunately made a career out of. I don't know why I should be surprised that anybody else might do it occasionally. All I can say is congrats, man. I assume all these games will be on TV that where we can get them, correct or not? Is it just the semis and the
they'll
finals?
They'll be on the CBS network.
Excellent.
Be on, and then Saturday's game, hopefully we'll be playing. We'll play at noon, and it'll be on CBS right before the Division I games get going.
Well, let's try to stay in touch as this thing goes and as you advance, which we'd really like to do, and try to make it part of the ride because, let's be honest, right now here, there ain't a lot to grab onto. So we will jump on the bandwagon, and we will happily adopt you and see where this thing's going to go.
Awesome. You are always welcome on the bandwagon, Dan.
Thanks, my friend. Always a pleasure. Good luck, and congrats again.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for the time. That is the Minnesota State Mankato men's basketball coach. Great guy. I can remember doing a show from Mankato where he came. I don't remember if the bar still exists, the bar restaurant that we did it from.
Yeah.
Remember the guests that day were Matt Margenthaler and Jack Morris?
I do remember it. Yeah.
How many years ago was that?
Probably seven.
Seven to ten,
yeah,
in that range?
I would say somewhere around there.
Great finish last night, man. And now, like I said, I'm tethered to this thing the rest of the way. I can't wait. So Tuesday's their next game. Tuesday night?
Yes. Yeah, Tuesday night
Ferris
is 6
State.
Central.
Okay.
That's 6 Central. So maybe we'll do a live listen-in at 6 o'clock on that Tuesday.
Even